For you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me.
Good morning, church. So good to see you here this morning. Are you ready to worship this morning? I am. It's just always a good time to come and gather with brothers and sisters so we can worship the one, the only one who's worthy to receive our praise and our honor and glory. Let's begin right there in prayer this morning. Father, thank you. Thank you for the opportunity that we have to gather here together. And Father, as we prepare for this time of worship, I ask, Lord, that you just help us to fix our focus on you and you alone, that we would put all the things that troubled us last week aside. Father, the things that could come up this next week if we're traveling or doing any of those things, help us just to put that aside for a moment and fix our focus on you. You are worthy to receive praise and glory and honor, and we want to worship you this morning. So, Father, would you direct our praise to you and you alone this morning? I'm grateful for Josh and for those who help lead us in worship this morning. I pray, Father, that as we sing, we'll sing unto you. And I pray, Father, that you'd prepare our hearts for the message to come. We pray all this in your name. Amen.
Well, he is worthy of our praise. Amen. Well, if you would, please stand. We're going to worship him this morning. It is a glorious day, and it is wonderful to be here with you, St. Andrew Baptist Church. So let's sing to him this morning.
I was buried beneath my shame. It was my sin till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my sin till I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. You called my name. Thank you.
chains broke at the weight of his glory. Amen.
I needed rescue. My sin was heavy. Would chains break at the weight of your glory? I needed shelter. I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future. My eyes are open. Cause when you call my name,
y'all are woke up this morning. Maybe enough to learn a new song? I hope so, because we're going to give it a shot. You know, this has been one that I've been listening to lately, and it's quickly becoming one of my favorites. And I think the chorus is just so apt, and I wanted to try to squeeze this in before the holiday season, you know, Black Friday season, you know, all that kind of stuff is coming up. But this chorus is just such a good reminder to us. And so I'm just going to play through it really quick, just to kind of teach it to you guys. And then we'll sing it. But the chorus goes like this. Not like that. There we go.
Jesus over everything, he reigns forevermore. Our song for all eternity, Jesus Christ is.
See, that's not too bad. So we're going to try it out.
He came from glory, took on flesh to save the lost, grace and mercy. Displayed upon the cross our redemption. He's the hope for all mankind, one name over everything, one name over everything. Jesus over. A song for all eternity.
over all anxiety, over troubles and all pain, over sickness and disease, for he reigns on the throne. All praise to him alone, one name over everything, over death and over sin, over hell, over the grave. Darkness bows and demons flee at the mention of his name, for he reigns. Sing it with me.
Jesus over everything, he reigns forevermore. A song for all eternity. Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus over.
Father God, we just lift our voices to you in praise this morning. Father, we thank you for who you are. God, we ask that you be pleased with us this morning, God.
See him there, the great I am, a crown of thorns upon his head, Father's heart displayed for us. Oh God, we thank you for the cross. Lifted up on Calvary's hill, we curse your name, and even still you bore our shame and paid cost. Oh God, we thank you for the cross. Behold the Lamb, the story of redemption written on his hands. Jesus, you will reign forevermore. The victory is yours.
Forevermore,
the victory is yours. We see
your praise. Endless hallelujahs to your holy name. Jesus, you will reign forevermore. The victory is yours. When the age of death is done, we'll see your face bright as the sun. We'll bow before the King of Kings. Oh,
singing to him in heaven. Lift your voices.
Behold the Lamb, the story of redemption written on his hands. Jesus, you will reign forevermore. The victory is yours.
You've done. God, I pray that you will just be with us this morning as we continue our worship, as we listen to your word. In your name, amen.
Morning. What a great time of worship that we have had. Thank you, Josh and Ben, for leading us in that. Today and next Sunday, I'm going to bring this sermon series to an end. For 6 months, we've walked through the Gospels, examining the life and the words of Jesus for the purpose of centering our own lives in and on Christ. And although this is the 23rd sermon in that series that I've preached, I still feel like I've just barely touched the hem of the garment. There's so much more that I would love to share with you, but quite honestly, I have a series of Christmas messages the Lord put on my heart a couple of months ago. And I have this great sense of urgency to share those with you in December. And so today and next Sunday, I'm going to complete this series. Today, I want us to focus together on the center of Jesus' life and ministry. Have you ever thought about that? What was the center of Jesus' life and of his ministry? What event? Or what saying? Or what teaching would Jesus have said, this is more important than anything else? Was it his miraculous birth? I mean, when God did that miracle, that deity became humanity, and he lived among us? Or was it the baptism of Jesus, when the Father spoke from heaven and said, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased? Maybe it was when Jesus overcame temptation. I mean, when he stared the devil down right in his face. And Satan did his wicked worst and did his evil best to try to trip Jesus up. And yet Jesus just quoted the scripture back with him, resisted him, and finally the devil fled from him. But no, it wasn't any of those events. Not even the great confession. That might have been my guess some time ago. When Jesus said to the disciples, "But who do you say that I am?" And Simon, soon to be called Peter, said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And I mean, that's when Jesus said, "And let me tell you, Simon Peter, upon this rock, on this great big bedrock of myself, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not even be able to stand against it." And that's the same occasion Jesus gave his disciples the keys to the kingdom of heaven, which was the gospel. And he said, with this key, with the gospel message, you can unlock heaven to anyone who is willing to believe and to trust in me. But my friend, no, as important as that event and all the others were, none of them were the center of Jesus' life and ministry. There was something else. And I know that what I'm telling you is true, because this is not something that I figured out. You know, if I had just figured it out, I'd have to leave a little room for doubt. Maybe I got it wrong. But no, in this case, Jesus told us. He said it explicitly. So there can be no mistake at all about what Jesus said was the most important event in his life upon the earth. Jesus made this declaration the very same week that he taught his disciples about the end times, that what we talked about last week when we looked at Matthew chapter 24. We find the words that Jesus spoke this time recorded by the apostle John in chapter 12, beginning in verse 23. Look with me at these. "But Jesus answered them, saying, the hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Most assuredly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat dies and falls into the ground, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces much grain." Jesus said, "Now my soul is troubled. And what shall I say? Father, deliver me from this hour. But for this purpose I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven saying, "I have both glorified it and will glorify it again." Do you see? Jesus is talking about his own death. He is talking about his death upon the cross that is going to take place just a few days after he is teaching this to his disciples. Jesus says, "This is the purpose for which I came into the world." Folks, Jesus' death upon the cross was the central event of his life and his ministry. Years later, the Apostle Paul would write to a group of Jewish believers that now lived, they were called the dispersion, the diaspora, because they had been forced out of their homes and they had gone to a region that we would call today Asia Minor. And there they lived and actually had several churches. And Paul wrote a letter to them that in our Bibles we call the book of Hebrews, because it was written to this group of Jewish Christians. And he summarized the Christian life near the end of that letter in Hebrews chapter 12. And he said this, "Therefore we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God." Now here's the question I want to ask you to think about with me this morning. Why should Jesus' death on the cross be at the core or at the very center of our lives? Clearly, Jesus said it was at the center of his, the most important thing he did. But why should it be at the center of our lives? Well, I want to tell you, first of all, because of what Jesus endured for us. Paul said, looking unto Jesus, who endured the cross. He suffered in my place and yours. I want to share with you a description written by a medical doctor who extensively studied the passion or the suffering of our Lord. And I'm going to read to you words he wrote. Before the mockery of trials began, the soldiers beat him in the face. During the night, they blindfolded him and repeatedly struck him in a cruel game of guess who. They knit together a crown of thorns and they pressed it down upon his head while blood trickled down his face. By the time Jesus stood before Pilate, he was already battered, bruised, dehydrated, and exhausted from a sleepless night. Pilate tried to placate the crowd and acquit himself from judicial murder by having Jesus scourged. When he was scourged, they stripped Jesus of his clothes. They tied his hands up above his head to a post. A Roman legionnaire took the flagellum, which was a brutal whip made of leather, thick leather straps, to administer 39 lashes to this victim. Each of these straps had on the end either a lead ball or a piece of bone embedded in the end of the leather, designed so that as the whip came across the back, it would dig into the flesh and rip it loose. With each lash, the leather straps cut the skin and eventually the tissues underneath, producing not only excruciating pain, but very heavy bleeding. The balls of lead made large, deep bruises that were broken open by subsequent blows. At the end of the scourging, the skin of Jesus' back hung in long ribbons, and the entire area was unrecognizable because of the torn and bleeding tissue. Let me remind you, this description is not from me. This is not the author of some novella trying to elicit the emotions of her reader. This is not just an emotional plea from a preacher. This is a medical doctor, one of the foremost experts in all the world, who had studied not only the scripture, but all of the historical records of the crucifixion. And I tell you, I have to wonder. I wonder if God actually showed the prophet Isaiah some 800 years before Jesus went to the cross. If he showed what was going to actually happen to Jesus in a kind of nightmare prophecy. Because Isaiah's words are so accurately descriptive of the actual events that took place. Isaiah said, "Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed." Folks, Jesus died an excruciating death to pay the penalty for each of our sins. Jeremy Ward is a physiologist at King's College in London, and he described the process of death by crucifixion. He said, "Someone nailed to a crucifix with their arms stretched out on either side could expect to live no more than 24 hours. 7-inch nails were driven through the bones in the wrist, which not only caused excruciating pain, but paralysis in the hand because the median nerve was severed by the blows. The feet were nailed to the upright part of the crucifix with the knees bent at a 45-degree angle so that the victims would try to push up using the strength of their thighs, but that strength lasted only a matter of minutes. Once the legs gave out, the weight would be transferred to the arms, gradually dragging the shoulders out of their socket. Following that, the elbows left the socket, and finally the wrist, to where the arms of the victims were stretched 6 or 7 inches longer. And then the victim had to bear the entire weight on his chest. He would immediately have trouble breathing as the weight caused the rib cage to rise up and force him into almost a perpetual state of inhalation and unable to exhale the air he had taken in. Suffocation would usually follow, and the resultant lack of oxygen in the blood would cause damage to the tissues, causing fluid to accumulate, including in the lungs and in the sac around the heart. This would make the lungs stiffer, making breathing even more difficult, and the fluid in the sac around the heart would impair the beating of the heart. Folks, I tell you, the physical agony that Jesus suffered on the cross was not the worst thing. Far worse than that was bearing the guilt and shame of our sins. Paul wrote to the Corinthians, and he said this: "For God made Jesus, who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him." And that is why later the Spirit inspired Paul to write to the Hebrews, "Looking unto Jesus, who endured the cross, despising the shame." You see, Jesus not only endured the physical pain, the spiritual agony of becoming sin for us, he also bore our shame. Psalm 22 is often given the name the Psalm of the Cross, because in it, the psalmist, inspired by the Spirit of God, actually quotes Messiah Jesus while he's on the cross more than 1,000 years later. For instance, in Psalm 22:18, he quotes Jesus as saying, "They divide my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots." And we all remember how much a part of that was the scene at the cross. But to the point of Jesus bearing our shame, he speaks in verse 6 of Psalm 22. Now he's quoting the Messiah on the cross. Listen to these words. "But I am a worm and no man, a reproach of men and despised by the people." Folks, Jesus calls himself a worm. A worm. The shame of sin, as he became sin for us, made the perfect, sinless Son of God feel as low as a worm groveling in the dirt. But the word that Messiah used is not the ordinary word for worm. We think of worm, we think about what daddies and granddaddies help their kids put on the fishing hook. Wasn't that kind of a worm? Jesus said literally, "I am the toloth," or sometimes the tola. This was a different kind of little worm, more like a caterpillar. And when little Jewish boys in their juvenile meanness would take the toloth and they would pinch it in two, they would let its blood run through their fingers, and their fingers would be stained a brilliant scarlet color. And mamas noted that, and then they began to gather these little worms and put them in bowls and crushed them and gathered this beautiful crimson blood and use it as the base of a dye with which they dyed material, with a resultant scarlet or crimson, beautiful color. In fact, some of the curtains in the tabernacle were colored with this very dye made from the blood of the toloth. Jesus said, "I am the toloth." And we remember the scripture says, "And the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all sin." Because he bore our shame, we are cleansed of our sin, and we need not be ashamed, for he has paid the penalty for it, and he has carried our shame away. Are you starting to see just a little bit about why Jesus' death on the cross is not only the central event of his life and ministry, why it should be the center of our lives and of our ministries? But the Spirit's not finished with Paul's statement to the Hebrew. He said, looking to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Why should Jesus' death on the cross be at the center of our lives? Because Jesus' death on the cross is what made him both the author and the completer of our faith. That's what that word finisher means. Completer, the one that brings it to perfect conclusion. You see, faith begins at the cross. Do you hear that? Faith begins at the cross. Because it is not enough for a person to believe that Jesus was a great preacher, or that he was a wonderful prophet, or even that he was a miracle worker. That's not enough. We must believe that Jesus, God's Son, died in our place upon the cross and then rose from the dead. And in response to the fact that he was the sacrifice for us, in response to that, then as we repent of our sin, we invite him to become the Lord, the master of our lives. But Jesus is not only the author of our faith, with faith beginning at the cross, he completes our faith by keeping us saved. Jesus promised, "Those that belong to me," listen to this, "shall never perish." Shall never perish. My friend, that is not because you or I are so strong in our faith, or so faithful in our walk, that we shall never perish. No. It is because Jesus is so strong and so faithful, and he keeps us saved. And that's why he can say, "Those that belong to me, nothing can ever happen. Nothing can take them away. They shall never perish," because Jesus is both the author and the completer of our faith. Why should Jesus' death on the cross be at the very core of our lives? Because you and I, who are followers of Christ, we are the joy that moved Jesus to endure the cross. We are the joy that moved Jesus to endure the cross. Look in Hebrews 12 again. "Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross." Isaiah also spoke of this in Isaiah 53. Right after he said, "But he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed." He added, "All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord laid on him the iniquity of us all." And then a few verses later he says this, "He shall see the labor of his soul and be satisfied." He shall see the labor of his soul and be satisfied. "By his knowledge, my righteous servant shall justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities." Folks, I picture it like this in heaven. I picture the Lamb of God who bore our sins and our shame on Calvary's cross. For each one of us, whether we arrive one at a time by death or whether we arrive by the tens of thousands because of the rapture, one by one, he's going to come up to each of us who have trusted him. Stand up with me here. And with a smile on his face, maybe a grin on his face, he's going to put his strong arm around our shoulders and say, Father, Spirit, elders and saints, this is Daniel, my brother. And I want you to know, here is a man who is pure and clean and righteous because I shed my blood for him upon the cross. And he's going to say, this is my sister. This is my sister, Liz, Daniel's wife, but my sister. What a beautiful life she has. Because I transformed her and that work in her to make her such a beautiful person began when I shed my blood for her upon the cross. And one by one, the Lord's going to come to us. And he's going to say, you are my joy. You are the reason I went to the cross. You're the reason I didn't call on those legions of angels who stood ready in the heavens to come and set me free from those who captured me and would nail me there. You, my joy, are the reason that as I suffered that pain because of your sin, as I endured the agony of separation from the Father because of the guilt and the shame of your sin, you're the reason I stayed. You're the reason I died. And the fact of the matter is, my friend, every one of us that gets to heaven will be there for one reason only. Because Jesus endured the cross and bore our shame. Because he is the author, the completer of our faith. And all of us who have put our trust and faith in him as a result of what he did, we are now his joy. Let me ask you a question. If you were to die right where you sit right now, would you be one of those who are the joy of Christ? Because you have responded in faith to what he did for you on the cross. Because you have trusted him as Lord, Master, Savior. Stand with me as we pray. And Father, I pray for all of us who are your joy. Not because of anything we did, but all because of what you did. But I pray, Lord Jesus, that your Spirit who lives within us who have trusted you will prompt us to often share our praise and our thanksgiving with friends and family, but with strangers also, that we may tell them why we are the joy of your heart and how we know that our faith will be completed and we will live with you forever. And then Spirit of God, I pray for those that are in this place today, but who have not yet responded to what Jesus did on the cross by trusting Him as their own Lord and the Master of their life and their Savior. Spirit of God, I pray that You maybe once again would speak to their heart, convict them of their own sin and their need for Christ. Convince them that He is the only way that their sin can be pardoned. That He is the only way their shame can be washed away. He is the only way that they can live with You forever. And I pray that as You give them faith, that You would move them to pray a prayer like this with me, to put their trust in Jesus, saying, "Dear Jesus, I know I'm a sinner and I desperately need a Savior. I know that I can never deserve to go to heaven. I know I can never work off the penalty for my sin. But Jesus, I believe You died for me on that cross. And I believe You rose from the dead, proving You really are the Son of God. Today I repent of that sin. And Jesus, I invite You to come into my life. Lord Jesus, I want You to become the Lord, the Master of my life, as well as my Savior. This day I begin to follow You. Today I begin to obey You. In Jesus' name, amen." If you prayed that prayer with me just now, then after we sing another song expressing our worship to the Lord, I'm going to ask you to go over to the Next Steps desk. One or more of our pastors will be over there. And just say to them, "I prayed that prayer with Brother Mike." They'll understand that. And they'll help you with what you do is your next step as a brand new follower of Christ. Now let's offer our praise. Let's offer our thanksgiving to the Lord who endured the cross for us.
What gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. For my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. The night is dark, but I am for by my side, the Savior, He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need, His power is displayed. To this I hold, my Shepherd will. The night has still I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to Him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall.
Time together on a Sunday night. We are so excited to be hosting this. This will be good for the entire family to come together to worship, to kick off our Advent season heading towards Christmas, which we are all super excited about. I know I am. And so that is 2 weeks from today. Don't miss out on that. And then also, we want to give you the opportunity to continue your worship this morning and how you give. Give back to the Lord because He has so greatly blessed you. So you could do that as one of our giving stations. You can give online, text to give. Also mailing as well. Check out our website to see how you can be a part of what San Andrew Baptist Church is doing in our community and around the world. Let's pray together and then we will be dismissed. God, we love you. We thank you so much for your sacrifice. God, we see that you reign above all of us. You reign above everything, all of our situations. God, you have that authority because you died on a cross and was risen again. God, you live, you are breathing in us, working through us. Lord, you are on the throne this morning. So God, I just pray that as we move through this week, as we are heading into just a really busy season for a lot of us, God, that we would just sit back and rest in your grace, knowing that you control it all and you have it all together. We love you. In Christ we pray. Amen. You're dismissed.